Well, good afternoon from London. The next session, I'm delighted to introduce Sergei Kuznetsov, Chief Architect of Moscow and First Deputy Chairman of the Moscow Committee for Architecture and Urban Development, and a great promoter and supporter of his city and of architecture, both within Russia and in the wider world. Sergei is going to give us a presentation about Moscow today and tomorrow, and Jeremy Melvin and I will then have a conversation and ask one or two questions. So Sergei, welcome, and over to you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Big salutes from Moscow. Yes, and I have this presentation quite short, and I see we have about 40 minutes, yes, to present something and to have some short conversation. Yes, Paul? Okay, Paul, Jeremy, good afternoon once again. And I will try switch it with my new OctoQ program. Yes, the main idea of Moscow development now is, I would say, going to wide context of worldwide megapolises, because we know that most energy and most business and social and other aspects now concentrated in world star polises. Yes, not even megapolises, but star polises. It's like a high league of the cities. So 10 years ago, because I am chief architect of Moscow almost for 9 and something years, I began with my working with the city, my practice as a chief architect with the post-Soviet Union capital, I would say. Yes, because it was a city with a very hard and difficult legacy of the Soviet megapolis, with all problems which was produced by Soviet city planning system. It's quite different to European character or world character of the city planning. So in terms of zoning, in terms of attitude to mass housing, to public housing, to different things which we now take as a normal in post-Soviet cities, as I think most of you know, that every time was some another view, I would say, yes, another point of vision and development. So with a lot of difficult aspects for architects and city planners. So and we share, of course, values with the rest of the big cities. It's not exception here. So culture, housing policy, sport, public spaces, education development, city, healthcare development, and lots of things which are necessary to have in the modern big city now. It's absolutely actual and relevant for Moscow development. And all of the spheres should be developed, of course, now. Once again, I will say it, after Soviet legacy, which an absolutely different way. So we start to rebuild many things in the city, and of course it was a question not only design of buildings, yes, and architectural design, but design of city infrastructure. And I think if you know more or less situation in Moscow planning, so Moscow is very monocentric city. We had a historical center, but Moscow now is a huge agglomeration, 100 square kilometers, and of course this little historical city center within Garden Ring, very difficult to manage all of city logistic, all of city using of transportation, of function distribution, and problems with hard traffic, for example, or with the migration, daily migration of the people from periphery to the center. It was a, I think, most significant, most well-known even problems of the Moscow, so because Moscow traffic jams was a famous traffic jam in the world, and one of the most problematic position in the city development. So we started with the development of city traffic infrastructure, with railroads, with the subway lines. We almost doubled for last 10 years structure of the under of the subway system. Moscow subway is a famous subway with architecture, but it was not so well developed, developed enough for this huge territory. So we doubled the lines on the subway. We developed another lines of the city trains with you see on the scheme two loops of the metro of the subway line and the city train line as a sign of perpetuum. So and besides this, we start to develop new city centers. Besides historical city centers, also Moscow city, it's quite well known district, but now we're developing in the more and more promoted vision with a bigger territory and more mixed development. So, and on the another side of the city, Southport is also former industrial zones, brownfields, when we're developing a new city center with like Moscow city, but on the absolutely opposite side of the city. And we have one more in, not only one, but several more in Komunarka, it's the new territory of Moscow, Skolkovo, it's an innovation city. River Arkhangelsk and other points, but these three points, red points on this map is the main thing for us, the main points of development now. So a couple words more maybe about this project. We finalized a big international competition for Southport recently, literally maybe 1 month ago. And among participants was a big world offices like Zaha Hadid architects, LP architects, SOM, Nikken Sekkei, so from Japan, Japanese office, several Russian architects, and the concept of Nikken Sekkei won in this competition. And these pictures you see will be designed designed by Nikken Sekkei proposal. So idea is, it's only a couple slides maybe here, but because big idea is to develop embankment, develop new system of the water trains and make some, like you know, term is traffic oriented development, not concentration near to traffic joints, so subway, new roads, cable roads, even you see on this slide, river transit, regular ships. So all of these things concentrated now in one point, and we develop districts like this in the city. So also Moscow city is not finalized, it's only beginning of the big city center. And on this picture you see proposal from Herzog Dömeron, who Switzerland office, famous architects, Peace laureates, and now they have a project in Moscow, not only this one but in Skolkovo also, another one in Moscow. And on the WAF was awarded last year Padayevsky, also project of Herzog Dömeron, and now they're quite successful in Moscow, so we have this big concept nearby, next step of the Moscow city development. And but you see, it's another character of the territory with this pond in the middle, and very, very calm and human scale districts, yes, with quite straight streets, the central square. as like a reflection of new ideology of the city. Not maybe so new, but we try to follow this ideology last 10 years, but idea of the European city with like a, in German, you know the term Gefassenstadt, city with the facades, with the faces. So it's very important now for us, and we try to follow this model, designing not the, you know, the field with the sculptures of the building, but the territory with the hierarchy of spaces, with the courtyards, with the lines of the streets, with the squares, with the greenery, with the ponds like this, with the cultural centers like this, like here. So we try to follow not only volumes of the buildings and the design of the facades, but the primary thing is the design of the territory, the zoning of territory. Just several examples from this project. You see it's a very atmosphere place, atmospheric place with a nice scale and city retail and so on. So I went through that. Yes, next big city center is Komunarka, Russian name. Komunarka is the city center of new added, recently added territory to Moscow, because Moscow was enlarged double times in 2012, 10 years ago, or almost 10 years ago, 12 years ago, and we also have a new city center there, so with a big cultural center, with business activities, hospital, and of course with the all necessary infrastructure like subway stations and lines and new roads and so on. So it's also it's now in the quite in the beginning, but also under construction. So mass housing. Next big question for maybe biggest one is a very boring and gray mass of mass dwelling in Moscow, like on this photo. You see it's famous prefabricated buildings in Moscow, and unfortunately very big percentage of city fabric in Moscow compounded by this mass housing. Looks unfortunately, it looks unfortunately quite ugly. Not only boring, but you know, in terms of conditions of the life inside of the districts, it's also not the best, not the optimal, honestly speaking, because this environment of, leads to quite low quality of the life, and so quality of the life. So our program of renovation, called renovation, the name of this program, renovation of this mass housing to new format. It's not only replacing of the buildings, but it's development of new districts. As another photo, it's in color, but it's also unfortunately quite problematic in the last 10 years of 20th century and first 10 years of 23rd. So we started with this. It's our benchmark, I don't know what our start position. So we elaborated new guides for design mass housing and prefabricated housing. It was in 2015. We started with very hard, tough rules for design with the standards. And following the standards, now we have an absolutely different mass housing districts with the replacing old one on the new one. And that's absolutely another scale and another quality of atmosphere in these districts, not only quality of housing, but quality of city space, cityscape. It's several examples, for example, from last international competition to this team, because we did it for Moscow for about 80 districts of Moscow were hold architectural competition with international participation, big international participation for different looks of mass housing proposals. So now we're in development of this program. I think it's maybe will take about 10 or 15 years since now and up forward, but we are going quite rapidly, so I see the first results already. It's just several pictures, several slides from this competition and the design which was taken as a basic for the development, and now we try to develop. Each district will have has its own phase, so it's very important not to go most much more further from this faceless grid design from Soviet dwelling. So next point is the subway station design. So it's all you see all these pictures. Of course, not all of Moscow subway stations look like this. Of course, we had a great station from Soviet architecture, like Pokrovskaya, Revolutsiya, Kievskaya, a lot of them in the city center. But on the periphery, most of stations look like more or less like this. It's quite boring, quite similar to each other, with a common construction scheme. So it's starting from Khrushchev period, like mass housing on the ground, on the top. So a mass metro station constructions also underground. So quite faceless, gray, and so very similar to each other. So we tried to shift it on the absolutely another way. Stations was also with a similar way like this. It was maybe 10 years ago level, but now we go further and organized also several very interesting international competitions for architecture. And now it's already realized new metro stations. So it looks absolutely different, very interesting, and even like architectural architectural events in the city. So with a quite strong impression. So they published in the Art Daily or another architectural international tabloids. So it's quite important for us and for Moscovites. I think it's absolutely another impression for metro station, for new stations than we used to have before. So yes, it's some examples more. We have now several very interesting, really interesting projects under construction. Even one of them with the Zaha Hadid office. So a really big, big, new, big moving direction. So public healthcare and another social oriented development. So the same situation, absolutely. We used to have Soviet style, like on the previous slide, and we have an early after Soviet design, very colorful and a bit like a bit mess, you know, in the architecture. So some attempts to I don't know, I'm used somehow this architecture. I would say this term is not architectural, but animated somehow. So, and we had this one, and now we start to design maybe more stylish things. So, we see the more stylish ways. Time to time, it's quite standardized by some rules, some guides. But mostly this is as normal different buildings with a quite high quality of the construction. It's idea is an absolutely different thing which used to be in Soviet period. So the same with the education. It's also slides with the Soviet schools and kindergartens and after Soviet. This is on the bottom slides in the corner is Herzog de Miranda, the circle one, circle, and another example. So you see the different architecture also after competitions, after invitation of some interest architects, even from abroad, time to time, and also the same ideas. Every building like this has to be some icon of the territory, I see. Because the problem with the mass housing from 80s or 60s, 70s last century. This is a big problem for identity of the districts. So every time if we do something interesting there, so it's important touch for animation, not only object personally, building personally, but all district when it's placed. So yes, this is, for example, campus for a new campus for Bauminsky University, a new campus for MGU Lomonosov University. Some of this building I had as an architect, not only chief architect of Moscow, but I designed some of them personally as a leader of architect team. So it's also for me quite important thing in I would say professional ambitions, yes, to do something interesting. Cultural objects. I have to say that since Soviet Union was a quite high level of cultural objects, it wasn't so boring and so faceless like previous categories like mass housing, social facilities, or metro station. And in Soviet Union, it was quite interesting, like circus in the Moscow, on the Vernadsky, several theaters. So we are in different situations on the field of culture development, but we also have some underdeveloped situation in the city with sort of museums, and now we try to take over this gap. So we have new expansions for famous Moscow museums like Tretiakov Gallery, like Pushkin Museum, like Museums of Kremlin, like on these slides, and also new institutions. For example, in these days, today and tomorrow, tonight, I will attend the party dedicated to opening of S2. S2 is a former power plant station transformed to the modern art cultural center by Leonid Michelson on the and with the Renzo Piano architect with this blue pipes on the roof. Very interesting, really interesting projects. One of the best maybe in Moscow realized in this year. So it's not only a significant projects, but regular projects also we try to do quite interesting. Like on this slide, it's on the periphery of the Moscow. So, yes, next slide. Sport facilities. For me personally, it's extremely interesting theme because not only in my past when I was quite active sportsman, but also now I try to hold me on the right feet and run marathon and so on. So for me, sport facilities personally, it's a very interesting theme for design. And for example, renovation of Luzhniki. Big arena, and not only big arena, but all territory, development of the embankment and the rhythmic gymnastics centrum was designed personally by me. So I'm involved as an architect also in this project. So for me, it's also personal, part of personal career to develop this structure. So we have a lot of interesting things. I think maybe some of you even attend some of this sport facilities Cups, maybe during World Football Cup in 2018, Moscow also among another cities, Russian cities, hosted World Cup, Football World Cup, and there was a final match on the Luzhniki Arena. It was quite impressive, and quality of the stadium, which was reconstructed, because it unfortunately had to be demolished according FIFA regulations about capacity, because Holt Arena couldn't capacity couldn't include more than I don't remember 72 visitors, and we had to have much more, 89 visitors, 1,000 visitors, and we had an agreement with the FIFA not to demolish historical arena and reduce a bit capacity, but design new stadium inside old one. So it was extremely difficult task in terms of engineering and architectural and logistic aspects. But we managed it, and now we have this really mixed of historical legendary stadium and new, very trendy, very comfortable and modern sport hub in the middle of Moscow. So in other several other examples also under construction now in Moscow, not so big as previous one. So even school sports centers, we have a lot now in Moscow with different design. So cityscape and city public space is also the big point. Besides Red Square with a very official status, I would say, without any normal city scape things like street cafe, restaurants, retail, and so on. And the new Arbat, it's Novaya Arbat in Russian, big avenue from Khrushchev period in Moscow, where unfortunately didn't have some interesting public spaces in Moscow. So we started also in this direction, very actively going. So we started with standards and some rules and guides to clarify, to clean the city out of this infra noising, I would say, yes, with this signs, with this cables, this city advertising, which was, it's, you see the photo 10 years ago, we had a city like this. Wasn't possible to, I don't know, make a photo in the city center without the visual noise like on this photo. So we also designed some rules, some standards, and new guides for this advertising, all of this info, and design new interesting city spaces like Triumphalnaya. It was on the previous photo. You are, I'm sure you can recognize this Zaryadye Park. A famous project now was represented also in the WAF a couple of 3 years ago, I remember. New city embankments, new spaces near to museums and other places, and on these slides also. So it's a very important and big part of the our architectural workshop here in Moscow. It's not only building design, but design of the street, city, streetscape, cityscape. So this is a slice from this regulations. Moscow River program also, I think, one of important, most important program in what we have now in Moscow. And a big part, not only new traffic line, because we started regular ships for regular connections, periphery and the city center with the, by the river, but redevelopment of the embankments bring the sport and other casual things on the embankments. Rebuilding even very important and very, I would say, official embankments, like embankment in the front of Kremlin. You see the photos from Zaryadye Park. It's on the left slide, that, how it used to be. This official, very boring and only with the cars embankment before. And now it's one of the most popular embankments in the Moscow, with a flying bridge, with the restaurants and cafe on the down level of the embankment, because embankment became two level, down one in the front in the level of the water, with cafe, restaurants and so on, and this top level for transit passage for the people. So yes, and this is Krimsky, another embankment which was also with just road and the cars, and now it became a public park with a pedestrian and bicycle ways and lines and some art facilities and so on. Oh, I try to accelerate this. Ah, yes, it's final slide. So, because I was afraid that I'm going over the time. So, yes, it's final slide. That's it. That's over. So maybe I heard you want to ask maybe some questions or something. So I finished with the presentation and I'm ready to give some comments, a couple more comments to this.
Sergey, thank you very much for that. That was a very comprehensive exploration of what you're doing in Moscow at the moment. A very big task and very impressive. May I ask a question about the river? Because we had a conversation when we were in St. Petersburg, when we discussed the difficulty for any city, Moscow or London, of really controlling the river when the city does not own the river. I think I'm right in saying that the Moscow River is the responsibility of a federal or state government.
Yes, we have the same problem here.
Not the city government.
Yeah, exactly so. Exactly. I impressed, Paul, how you're involved in our very, not maybe evident aspects here. Yes, we have the same station here status, because Moscow River, like any water in our country, under management of federal government. Yes, that's a part of our legislation. But embankment, of course, and line of connection, front line of the river, of course, under management of the city. So we try to communicate with our federal colleagues, but it's not too easy, maybe every time. For example, I remember for Zaryadye Park, it was a really tough job to persuade them, give us possibility to change the embankment, because it's the nearest part of the Moscow River in the city, only 90 meters. It's quite, unfortunately, quite narrow. So it was a big problem to make a flying bridge, to make this little extension to the river, because we need to maybe add 1 or 2 meters like a reclamation from the river to the embankment to organize this level, down level. But finally, we successfully managed it. I'm really glad to do it. So, yes, we have this nuance, but in most questions, we have agreement with the federal government.
You did a very good job there. Jeremy, did anything strike you particularly about this presentation? There's clearly a huge effort being made to really revive a kind of individual architectural style for the city rather than the standardization of much of the Soviet era.
Well, I think it's absolutely fascinating, and of course it's very easy for us sitting in, you know, complacent London to forget that Moscow is actually the second biggest city in Europe, and the first biggest is Istanbul, and London is only the third largest. And actually dealing with this vast territory, Sergei, you were saying, covering 100 square kilometres, is very, very difficult. What strategies can you adopt? And I think you talked very interestingly about different sorts of building types and how they can make a contribution to what's emerging as a multi-centered city. But I suppose the question that fascinates me, because I've only really visited the inner city of Moscow, is how do you deal with the heritage, its architectural heritage, which of course goes back to the Middle Ages, goes back to the Kremlin and other buildings of the pre-Soviet era, but also, of course, there are some very, very significant works of the Soviet era. And I just wonder how you can make those very different sorts of building work within the concept of the city as it looks to the future for the 21st century.
Yeah, Jeremy, thank you. Yes, it's also very touchable, maybe sensible question for us, the heritage question, because, you know, maybe Moscow has a three heritage objects of UNESCO heritage, but it's Moscow Kremlin, Kolovinskaya, and Novodevichy monastery. So, but and we have some really really big security protected zone for not only for this heritage objects, for this famous monuments, but for many many monuments and heritage buildings in the city center. And yes, the first toll is a very big part of the public discussion, I would say, because once we touch every building, is not even without status of heritage building, but only if it looks like heritage building, it's quite old, for example, 100 years plus, I would say. It's every time very hard and tough discussion with a lot of people who charged on the not only maybe official protection of this building, but some activists, some public groups who connected around of the heritage point or the heritage discussion. So for us, yes, it's not, of course, I know some had some conversation with the Italian colleagues from the Rome, for example, and I know for in the Italy, for example, to build one station of subway, it's a big defeat because big story, big deal because of archaeology and so on. Of course, in Moscow, not so difficult situation, but during Zaryady Park construction, we had a really big part of our job with the archaeologists, and that also was very interesting. And we tried to communicate with the people, we tried to communicate with the UNESCO official, for example. I have been twice to UNESCO office in Paris during the Zaryady Park design and construction. And Zaryady Park was acknowledged by UNESCO as an example for city centers, for design and city center. And also I was recommended to several cities as an example, as a consultant for example, I was in a jury in the Sofia, Bulgaria, for redesign of central part of the Sofia, because Sofia also has a big heritage part as a former Roman city, and also with archaeology and quite different. So now we have several very interesting projects with the heritage part, like Badaevsky industry, former Badaevsky factory, it's a brewery, former brewery.
Thank you.
19, so yes, it's my long story, but we have several very interesting examples here. With the Herzog de Miron, we do this project, so maybe it's worth to see.
You showed buildings that you and your design team have produced, I think, for Moscow. Can I ask, how many architects do you have, and how many buildings do you design each year?
You know, Paul, it's not so. I personally, in my team, I have about maybe 40 people in our committee, but it's not designing architectural team. As a team for we design some rules, some guides. It's operational work, not design work. But when I design something as an architect, as an author of the building, I work with different offices, because I have I don't know, architects with whom I feel myself comfortable to do something together. So I work in partnership with my previous former office speech, like example, when I used to be chief of the office with Sergei Chopin, for example, design Luzhniki Stadium together. Or I can design something with another architect, for example, Zaryady Park. I also was a chief of the project team. And you know, we designed it with the dealers Cafidio Renfro office and with several Moscow architects. It was a quite big team, and it was under my architectural management. I acted not only client from the city, but also like a part of the team and chief of the team. I designed the design, some design codes, some design rules, some functional program and so on. It wasn't only control and paying money. So yes, normally it's collaboration with somebody. So I have a lot of architects who are ready to do something in the team, and we do it time to time.
Well, I think that's a very positive note to bring this session to a close. I observe that question of working with other people seems to be a theme of what is going on with Moscow at the moment, where there are homegrown Moscow and Russian architects, but there are also overseas architects working in the city, pointing to, I think, a positive future for a city which is grappling with the problems of post-Soviet standardization, but seems to be doing so in a spirit of great optimism and in a belief that design and architecture can make a real difference. So, Sergei Kuznetsov, thank you so much for being with us, and best wishes for the future.
Thank you, Paul Jeremy. Thank you very much for having me. Thank you.